Okay, so I'll do just a couple minute intro about the group. We did start as a function as a service. That's kind of where serverless movement started, but over the years it became like a mindset and new agility. We noticed a disconnect between business needs and IT, and we're trying to close the gap. So we call it serverless mindset, where you're focused more on helping business drive forward rather than pimping our cars. In the past, because change in IT happens top down, we used to give the books and point to product management courses. But since COVID started, we wanted to be more impactful to the community and started having more business-focused meetups like this one, like the last one Lynn gave us, to connect businesses and IT. And also, there is lots of professionals in the cloud, regardless of the cloud you are in the group. So we are giving free advice and even offering consultation services. And when the going was tough, we were helping people connect community members, connect with the employers. So we do have a survey for you to help us be better. Like, do only the first part of the survey. You don't have to go through the details of our remaining two parts. It's going to enable you to win Manning Rafa Publishing prize at the end of the meetup. So hang with us. It's a really good company. There is ton to learn. Like, there are other good publishers as well, but I like their pricing. It's affordable and always on the edge with the good quality of the products, whatever you choose. So about the upcoming meetups I have planned already. So there is a big trend of moving enterprise data warehouses into the cloud. Two leading data warehouses, whatever your cloud vendor will tell you, are Snowflake and BigQuery. And next month we're going to have Luck from Google talk about benefits of moving the data in the cloud from AI point of view. He's a book author. He wrote a bunch of books, Machine Learning Design Patterns, the latest one. Like, what I wanted to share, like, in IT, you rarely read old books. This is a book from 2017 that he wrote, updated 2018. It's still ahead of its time. So I'm excited to see what we're going to learn from Luck. And then, so Snowflake meetup is still in the works. Felipe Hoffa, if you're listening, we want to see you here. And in September, it's another business and IT oriented meetup. It's about connecting chatbots to the contact centers. So yes, everybody talks about chatbots, but how to put them to use in the contact centers? Google made the big inroads on that front by having the product called Contact Center AI. But it's confusing. So I've been watching the companies struggling in that space because there are multiple versions of Dialogflow. There is multiple vendors that there are. And there is a really timely book that Lee Bronstra from Google wrote. If you cannot wait till September, get the book from iPress. Kindle version is available. And we need you to present as well, regardless how big or small it is. You don't have to be a world celebrity to be with us. Just to want to contribute and not pitch. Help us. And help others, and then raid the meetups so more people like you can see it. So how we ride with this meetup? It's pure accidental, really. It was seen at article. It's hyperlinked here that published the story back in 2017 about Messina's projects, and then this year I became friends with Goran from Sweden, who was talking at NVIDIA conference about smart cities, but his projects are kind of experimental. It's not something that business can take away to put production. So I just pointed Goran to Antonio's website, and I was blown away to see how much further ahead you are now. Like, and you were even kind enough to give me the walkthrough, all the projects you have. So it's almost like a recipe cookbook that cities around the world will be able to cut and paste and get from Antonio. And you went so far that there is even hardware now that you don't need to make your own, that you can order from Italy if shipping would work. So Antonio, thank you for being with us. Thank you for sharing, enlightening the folks about it. Take it away.
Thank you, Daniel. Thank you for the introduction. Thank you, everybody, for being here. I try to pass some information and to make them as much attractive as possible. So let me share my screen so that you can follow my slides. Share. I think you should see the presentation. Is it okay? Are you looking at my screen?
Yep, I can see it.
Okay.
Not in presentation mode, but we can see the deck. Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So The title is more or less this one: Software Defined Smart City, Integrating the Cyber World with the Internet of Things. So this is what I will try to cover. Just a few words about who I am, and mainly to give credits to the different groups of people that are contributing to these results. I teach at the University of Messina, that is in Sicily, in the southern part of Italy. So there I have a research group that is named MDS Lab, that is specifically focused on smart city, cloud, fog computing. So it's a research group in the university. Then I am the director of the SINI Italian Lab on smart cities and community. SINI is the Italian Consortium on Informatics that involves at the moment 40 different universities. So the lab more or less is made of about 500 researchers distributed all over Italy in different cities. And it is specifically focused on smart cities. And then part of the results that I will show comes from the SmartMe.io startup company that was created 4 years ago, that cooperates both with the research group, with SINI, and brings into the market some of the research products that we develop. Okay, so we will talk about smart city, this is clear, and I would like to give my view of what a smart city is. It's a complex environment where we have lots of process and some process that needs to be observed. And so we have to sense and we have to transmit the information, to share the data, communicate, connect. All this data to be properly analyzed using adequate models that are able to understand what is happening in our environment and also to forecast what will happen in the future. And then, according to these results, we have to manage the situation. So we have to go back and actuate some specific action to control the different process. So this is the way in which I see a smart city. Of course, it depends also on the point of view, because if we look at the authorities who is in charge of ensuring the proper functioning of a metropolitan area, then is interested in traffic control, probably in monitoring the quality of the air, in putting in place adequate instruments for trash management and more. If I look at the business, the companies, they are interested in a stimulating environment where data can easily be shared, you can trust each other, you can save money moving from one point to another, and you want to improve also the quality of the production on one side and of the life of the worker. And if I am a citizen, I am interested in other things, mainly related with the parking solution, so smart parking, or avoid real traffic jam, and at least be informed about in real time about a traffic jam, or I want to predict the amount of time I will take to move from point A to point B. So depending on who I am, probably different aspects of smart city should be considered, and the different interests are there. So we hear about smart city since a long time now. And of course, on one side, we can have an opinion that say that they are transforming the way in which we live and we work. But at the same time, it's a sort of abusive work. It's a over-hyped world, and sometimes also under-delivered. So lots of discussion and from a concrete point of view, sometimes not so much has been done. The reality is that smart cities are usually complicated, frustrating, overhyped, but I really believe that they represent the future for all of us. And there are lots of forecasts, for example, regarding the 5G and the use of 5G in urban environment. It seems that it will generate more than $17 trillion of US dollars by 2035. This is an enormous amount of money. So it means that if we are able to adequately manage and control the process that govern a smart city, probably there will be really benefit for all of us. We have also to consider that there are clear trends that states that people are moving into city. They are leaving countryside and they are entering the city. So the global population living in urban areas is growing for more or less 50% of the population to 70% by 2050. And this is an impact extremely huge that needs to be adequately governed. And we can observe this kind of things in the whole Asian area. In China specifically, by 2050, we will have more than 250 million of people that will enter urban area. And of course, also in India, in this big country, of course, we have big numbers. And we have to take care of
it. Antonio,
yes?
I'm sorry, but were we supposed to see the next slides in the presentation? Because we're still seeing the cover one with the title.
We're seeing the edit mode. Maybe your presentation mode is on a different monitor.
Okay. Sorry. I'm sorry about this. Let me check. Let me check what is happening here.
Yes.
Okay.
You're sharing wrong screen.
Schermo intero. Condividi. So I'm sorry about this. Is it there? Can you see it?
Yes. Slide okay. 9.
Sorry about this. I don't know what I did. Maybe something wrong for sure. Okay. So let me screen. Okay. So I was trying to say now that, people are leaving the countryside, they are entering the city, and this creates lots of problems if not adequately governed. At the same time, we see that there are about 150, maybe a little bit more, cities that have published a smart city strategy. But then only the 10% of this city really have defined activities and targets to be reached. And only half of this number, that means about 10, maybe less of 10 cities, they really move forward the implementation of these services. So, okay, dealing with smart city is extremely challenging and a very hard goal, but we have to manage. Cities are complicated, but there are interesting examples that we can look at, like, for example, Shanghai, where a huge amount of people live there, more than 20 people, and so very complicated environment. But they set up a program management office that try to coordinate different processes that develop inside a city. And this is a good strategy. We have also other example where there is a strong attention on the interaction of the different process. So governance is important. And in Tokyo, they have organized a plan with different targets to be reached. And there are interesting results with regard the involvement of citizens, for example, reporting incidents or illegal parking or things like this. Solutions are usually complex. There are lots of vendors, technology that can be used. And by experience, I can say that most of the city managers get a little bit confused when they listen to this technology, to the solutions. So they don't really understand what is happening there. And of course, so each vendor say that his specific solution is the best, is the more adequate, and this increase, of course, the confusion. And then there is always the lock-in vendor problem, because very often these solutions are not open. So the municipality are also scared that if they start a process, then they will remain somehow linked to a vendor and they will not be able to move forward in the future. Okay. On top of all of these, we have to consider security issues. Security is important in general in ICT, in all the distributed system, even more if we think in a complex environment such as a smart city, where also there are so many potential users. We have lots of examples where security has created a serious drawback because it was not adequately considered. There are examples in London, there are examples in Singapore where a huge number of 100,000 of medical records were violated, or also in Malaysia. And the situation is even more complicated and difficult to manage if we consider that nowadays we have a huge amount of objects, little objects, simple devices like smart meters, plugs, cameras, and so on, that are distributed in our geographical environment. And we have thousands and thousands of such devices. So they, in some sense, are potentially a sort of door that can allow access into the complex system. So security is crucial. And if it is not adequately managed, we know by experience that there are critical situations and consequences, like what happened in Ukraine a couple of years ago, where the electrical grid was somehow touched and thousands and thousands of people were left without electricity for half a day. Another problem that we have to consider looking at smart city is the sustainability of the projects. Usually the project starts because there is some financial support, but then when the financial support ends, the project is over, and you risk to lose all the good things that have been done. So sustainability is an important aspect to be considered to ensure that the project continues and is able to generate some revenue that can be reinvested to keep the project going. There are some interesting examples of this, like in the city of Hangzhou, where cooperation between public and private has been exploited, and in that case, the goal was to reduce the congestion in the city, so some infrastructure were set up, and the city of Hangzhou, that was one of the most congested in China, in a couple of years improved a lot its position. Okay, so this is just a very quick introduction, and what is important, I think, is that all of the process that I'm trying to describe assume strong technological support. It's crucial, it's at the base, but probably it's not the greatest challenge. Technology is there, we can use it. We are the problem. The problem is to collaborate, is to create a community, to involve people, city manager, policy maker, industries, all together trying to look at the future of the city. So I don't really believe that if you have a nice project and you impose it to your community, it will be a success. Very likely it will be ignored. You have to involve people since the very beginning, so they feel the project as their own project, and in some sense they get educated and they start using it in the proper way. So we started with this consideration about 5 years ago, and we launched a crowdfunding initiative at the University of Messina. I was said it was the first crowdfunding initiative from an Italian university. Crowdfunding is not so popular in Italy, so they didn't believe that it could be something useful, a success, but instead it was, because we were able to collect more or less
Antonio, your screen froze, or it's mine.
I think it's internet. Okay, sorry, yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just saying it's definitely Antonio's feed because the rest of us are here. Just maybe give him a minute.
It might come back. We'll cut this part out. Hopefully he comes back.
Yeah.
Does he know?
You might need to rejoin. We'll see what.
Okay, works. But maybe he did, maybe he's not aware. Let me email him. I guess he realized.
Yeah, he dropped off there, so we'll probably rejoin.
You don't have his phone. Who here? You're from Italy.
Yeah, I contacted him already.
Oh, good. That's good. I only have email. That doesn't fly. That probably have some IoT gadgets communicating with one another.
I contacted him by Skype, so I saw that he's online. So he will be back, I guess.
Thank you. Thanks. So you're the part of the project with him.
Yeah. I have been involved like for a couple of years now, like four mm-hmm. or 5 years. I'm doing a PhD there in Italy, and mm-hmm. they will be done in a couple of months, 2-3
Lovely.
Months.
Lovely. And what's your specialty? He has so many projects. It's like a cookbook. You don't know where to start. Everything.
Yeah. You're right. At the beginning, it was very difficult for me to understand what they are doing, but like day by day, you get inside the project, and by the end you realize what you are doing. So we are doing a lot of stuff. My master's degree, it was more related to networking, like routing, switching, and this kind of stuff. Then I switched a little bit to cloud computing, then serverless. So I'm doing a lot of stuff in parallel.
That is cool. So you're helping him with the infrastructure.
Yeah. I built a couple of subsystems you will see in the presentation, like the one for networking, another one for what we are calling deviceless, mm-hmm. which is kind of serverless at the edge. Mm-hmm. So I was the designer of a couple of parts.
That is cool. And like before we started this meetup, he gave me an overview of what he's going to talk. So his approach to cloud was really interesting. Because people are polarized, like some companies will never, or cities will never use Azure, or never use Google, or never use. With your approach, it's kind of, it is not, like it didn't sound as true serverless. Maybe we can talk us through before he joins in.
Yeah.
But it was infrastructure as a code that you can deploy anywhere, including on-prem.
Yeah, and you don't even care about the underlying configuration of the board of the IoT device. So you have like a container that you can access through SSH, for example, and you mm-hmm. have your virtual pins that are connected to physical sensors or actuators, and you can use them as they were like physical, but they are virtual. And this abstraction is made by serverless. We're talking mm-hmm. about deviceless. So you have an abstraction of the physical mm-hmm. pins, and we are using a virtual file system using Fuse. Mm-hmm. So we are abstracting the file system, and then you can interact with them through FAS.
Hmm. That's interesting. Can you try to, did you get back from him? Maybe he didn't get your Skype message.
Okay, you know, I will call him right now. It's better okay. and faster.
Yeah, and I will look for his old presentation. I don't know how much he changed it since he demoed it to me. So at least you have something to look at mm-hmm. while they're getting oriented. I think it's shared with you, Jonathan. So let's see.
Oh, with the older version. Sorry, I see.
Yeah, the older version. Hi, Zoran. So you came in when a presenter lost internet connection. It's Sicily, after all. So who knows? Yeah, how about Zakaria? How about your internet over there?
Actually, I'm not in Italy.
Uh-huh.
Right now, I'm in Morocco. I got stuck because of COVID-19.
Ooh.
Oh, dear.
So you may not be able to reach him either. Like, is he replying to you on Skype?
I'm trying to join him over WhatsApp.
And then I found presentation. Let's see. So we'll improvise until he gets back. So this is what I have. Hey, he's in. Oh, that's me.
You're tricking us.
Déjà vu. It's a little bit different. It's not the same. Zachary, you cannot fake it. Can you talk us through? Is this something you did with him or it's new to you?
Okay. This part I was not this part I was not involved in. It was very it was like before I start with them.
Anybody else from Italy, like that's close to him, that has his phone number?
I will try just a couple of minutes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let's see how we can best use time. We can cut this out of the final video for people interested in just smart cities, not this group. Stop presenting. Okay. Any questions so far on what Antonio covered? Like that we can start discussion already. Let's pretend this is like Lean style. Meet up, no PowerPoint, and then we finish chapter one. Now we're discussing. Lynn, let's be in your school. So, with me, I like the aspects that he's playing, that it's not about technology, it's about organization, it's about empowering everybody on the project. So I think trying to organize this meetup to get more people from the cities and communities, we're on the right track, because it's not about us, it's not about particular cloud vendor, it's about like group collective intelligence.
Absolutely, yeah, it's definitely a people problem. The engineering is engineering, but you need the right champions at the right levels in order to push it through.
Anybody from Canada, who, Lynn, you're here.
Yeah, well, you know, because of the unrest we've had in Minneapolis and the discussions around policing, there's been extended discussions around the use of cameras and smart technologies, body cameras on police officers. And I've actually served as kind of a tech liaison in some of those, because again, there's a big gap between what people think happens and what actually happens. And there is a need for people who understand, for example, how machine learning actually works, and where you could test for, let's say, bias in facial recognition, how you would do that, because the general public really does not have the depth of knowledge to trust the IoT technologies, and they generally will mistrust them with good reason. But I just find that if you explain exactly, like, this is how it works, here's the limits, here's what you look at, you know, with knowledge comes comfort, basically. And so I have been involved in a lot of these discussions around camera technologies here in the Twin Cities.
Kind of explainable AI.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you also worked on IT projects. Actually, it was your work early, like many years ago. What were your IoT projects at the time? Was it smart city related? Like,
I had a really large multi-year project about 5 years ago that was around industrial manufacturing. It was IoT enabling. The physical device was a sprinkler device. So it was like sprinklers for, you know, stadiums and golf courses. And the idea was it had knobs to stick a device on it to Wi-Fi enable it, and then to create the solution so people could control it remotely. So we were one of the first people out on AWS IoT. So what might be interesting to the group is using specialty cloud services rather than roll your own, and why you might want to do that. And the short answer is certificate management of devices. There's other reasons, but most people are doing it wrong. And this is yet another reason why smart city solutions are having problems with acceptance because the security is done incorrectly. Mm-hmm. And there's many, many cases of a single certificate being used for all devices, for example. There's a website called Shodan, which is it's like Google IoT for Internet of Things. And actually one of the things I had to do with this engagement is I had to show that a competitor we acquired was actually doing that. And so all of their, you know, well, I was like, okay, do you want me to turn on the sprinklers in Dubai? Because I can. So, you know, as with a lot of things in IT, security gets overlooked, but I think that really hurts adoption, justifiably. So, you know, kind of, you can roll your own certificate solution, but it's really difficult. You'd have a team. So one of the things to weigh is whether you want to pay a cloud vendor to do some of that, and all of them have it now, or if you want to, you know, pay employees to do that. But that cost was not considered with this solution. So that was a big learning from it. It was a classic microservices, so that was cool. We really pushed AWS. At that time, Lambda wasn't available in VPCs. You know, they wanted to do everything in Lambda, but to integrate the security, the certificate security with user security, we had to build our own integration piece, and we wanted that behind multiple VPCs for security. And, you know, the front end was Lambda triggered. So it was a hybrid architecture. It wasn't pure serverless. So I don't know if that's what you're looking for, but It was interesting. I mean, we went from nothing to watering the president of the company's lawn in 10 months, though. So serverless was proved up because the previous team that got fired didn't deliver anything in 3 years, and they tried to do it on-prem. And that's why they brought me in, because they wanted to have modern cloud architecture. But, you know, companies don't want to change unless they have pain. And so they had pain.
That's correct.
Yeah, but it was cool. I mean, it was really interesting. The other really big thing that we learned was about the importance of simulators, which I think everybody knows, but it's more complicated when you're going through cloud. Because like when you do the integration testing, because it's as much as you try to make the simulator identical to the real devices, you don't. And so that's really a challenge, right? And then if you don't have that, then you're not going to test, which that's a different challenge. So it was a fun project, but it was definitely a lot of new stuff. So the security, the simulators, the not pure serverless, and then if you rely on the cloud vendor and they change their implementation, it can break your solution, mm-hmm. You know, because it was, at that time, IoT was really new, and we were using MQTT. So it's another reason that we did that. So anyway, I don't want to monopolize, but
it's all good. I asked. Anybody else worked on cool IoT projects while we're waiting for Antonio and Zakaria? Who else? We had somebody who's leading. I forgot the name.
Daniel, this is Nathan.
Nathan, yes. What can you share with your initiatives? Like, what problems do you see putting them to life?
Right. So I think the message that was given initially in the presentation, that the cities are confused and there are so many OEMs around who just go there and tell that, you know, I am the best. And that's the reality of life, and which we also very strongly believe. And that is the problem we have been solving for our customers. So we are a company, so I work for Hewlett Packard Enterprise. And we are OEMs of some of the products, but then I belong to the systems integration division. And we have been talking to our customers and helping them create their roadmap for the smart city journey, and also the IIoT, which Lynn was talking about, right? So, by getting their business users, and the stakeholders in a single room, listing down their pain points, and then creating the business solution for their problem and then applying technology over it is something that we do. So yeah, some of the very, very interesting projects that we have done, in fact, some of the large cities worldwide, around 13 to 14 cities across the globe has been delivered by us, wherein we normally involved from the very initial stages of the project with the customer. We understand what are their pain points. And the main thing that we focus upon is implementing some kind of a, so we have created a reference architecture for smart cities, which can, you know, which can cut the silos and create a holistic architecture so that it can take any kind of a protocol or any kind of a, OEM solution and create a unified platform for the and a single source of truth for these cities. Daniel, I can't hear you. Daniel, you're on mute.
Sorry, I was trying to share, like, the problem doesn't seem to be technology, but empowering everybody to participate, to want to play with you. So like Hewlett-Packard can create strategy, this company can create strategy, but cities are like almost non-profits. They can do the work, they don't need to do the work. So it's kind of, it's not like a bank, profit shareholder driven.
Right.
Like, and so its motivation is more like socialistic societies. It reminds me more where I come from than the banks. So it's a different motivators how to.
Absolutely, absolutely. And those are the motivators, you know, that what we normally speak to our customers, those are the motivators which have to be created. And cities, there are cities who ask us, you know, how we can create, how we can increase our revenues, how we can stop the revenue leakage, mm-hmm. how we can, you know, how we can monetize the services. And those are the most important questions which needs to be answered individually for the individual cities. Because, right? And that is exactly what I heard in beginning of this meeting, right? Each city is different.
So when I first met Antonio, like, we had similar call one-on-one, he was emphasizing importance of communities. Is there anybody here who knows any communities in North America, let's say? Like, because he started crowdsourcing that are related to smart cities. Like, I know some IoT groups, but either robots or vision or self-driving car, but nothing holistic as a city. Anybody aware of anything who could benefit from Antonio's message and menu?
Yeah, and in fact, his message was not complete. So before he...
Well, that's just it. He'd got to the point where he had introduced a bunch of the hurdles, and he was talking about, you know, the financial sustainability and talking about the security and the involvement, but we hadn't yet got to the point where he started to talk about how to get over those hurdles or how to address them or how to abate them. So that's very unfortunate. Mm-hmm. I wonder, it's kind of surprising he hasn't been able to reconnect. There must be some sort of a permanent outage or power failure or something.
Oh, let's Google.
Did you get a hold of him, Zachariah?
I've tried to reach him, but he's not answering. I don't know what's wrong. It seems even his phone is not working.
Oh, my God. Nobody hacked the system. Dark web. So what can we do? Like, I'll hang around, like, until he comes back. Like, we can continue chatting. Any other topics? Like, we have lots of people with different skills and interests here.
I contacted some of our colleagues, so they will try to join him by phone.
Is there anybody who worked with him on this presentation team that can walk us through the slides?
Let me check who is here. No one.
Okay. So, you know, we can eventually reschedule again. Third time the charm. First right. one was 101, now one too many, and then, but I'll hang in here, wait for him. You never know, like, and then even worse comes to worst, we'll finish the presentation. Whoever can hang and chat, like, John, what do you think? Does it make sense?
Yeah, we can hang in here a little longer, but I think a lot of people probably want to get going if it's not going to happen, unfortunately. But we can hang and chat for a little bit.
Okay. And I will record it. If he comes back and you go, it will be recorded and posted. It just, you know,
you can edit out all this stuff. Yeah. And then
anybody else wants to share? This is now like a true meetup where lights went out and we can chat about anything dear to your heart.
This was almost like a trailer for a movie.
How are you, Ivan?
Okay, yourself?
Ivan is one of the first people I met when I immigrated to Canada in 92. And he was a software engineer and the pilot at the time. And later on, he switched to civil engineering. So.
Yep, time for a change. But you never really leave computing. I mean, you know, even in civil engineering, we're using things like AutoCAD and things like HecRes and other software. And it turns out a lot of those programs are programmable. There's another program called PC Swim, which is programmable in Python, for instance.
So that's what brings you here, Smart Cities, because this is first time you're with us, like in fourth year.
Yeah, it seemed like a good match because I'm sort of interested in what we can do with that nexus between civil engineering and IT, and Smart City seems to be pretty close to that.
There is just not too much movement here. It's ridiculous how slow things are moving. Have you seen the video about from CNET that blew me away? Every one of you saw that video?
I haven't.
Okay, I can play that just for you to see what he did in 2017. If the sound will work, like I don't know how it's going to work if I'm playing YouTube. Let's see. So I will share this while waiting. So I will stay here. You guys are free to leave. Have a good weekend, whoever leaves. And then if he comes back, we'll record everything in post. And this is.
You will record it on Facebook?
Sorry?
You will post it on Facebook?
No. No, this is a meetup page. So when you go to the event, it explains. So the title for the meetup was copied from this CNET article from 2017.
Okay.
Can you hear the sound?
But this ancient town is transforming itself into a city of the future, and in the process, beating Silicon Valley at its own game.
Can you see this?
Yep.
Yeah.
We can hear it.
I've come to Messina's town square to watch the popular noon bell tower show. My tour guide is University of Messina professor Antonio Pugliavito. But he's given me a tour of a future city.
By falling by the church without changing practically the position, the system realized that this is the main church and provides the information on the church itself.
I'm getting a glimpse of an experiment called Smart May. It's a university-led effort to try to transform Messina and other Sicilian towns like Catania into the smartest of the smart cities.
So what does it mean to be a smart connected city? This is Sicily, after all, not Silicon Valley. And there aren't a bunch of delivery drones or self-driving cars, at least.
But Sicily does have sensors, lots of them in lots of places. They're tucked away in some parking lots, bus stops, streetlights, and buildings.
This is one of the boxes that we have distributed in the city, about 35 of these boxes that you can see also on the map.
The idea is to build, from the ground up, a citywide network of sensors, including tapping into the ones in people's phones.
We want to use the same unifying technology to dialogue and interact with all of these objects.
The data, like temperature and whether a taxi is nearby, can then be used to make life better and the city more efficient. For example, there's a camera in the airport that shows if it's crowded, so you can decide if you need more time to get through security.
There is a thermal camera inside that just gives real-time information that you will see also on the website of Marni.
There's also an app for mapping potholes so the city can make quicker repairs.
So this phone just recorded a pothole. This map here, real-time, actually shows you where the pothole was reported, what time,
and if enough of them get reported, then the city will go and fix it. There's a prototype of a smart garbage bin that can tell the city it needs emptying when the trash reaches a certain level. There's a solar-powered bus stop that charges your phone, monitors air quality, and tracks traffic patterns. And the buses get better.
No.
They make the buses better. You can find an open parking space and reserve it.
While we are driving, then if we decide to park, the app will indicate the available parking place nearby where we are, so we can reserve, and it will drive us to the place. The technology is a magnetic sensor that is developed with the components produced by ST Microelectronics.
Now, I know what Messina's doing may sound a little familiar. After all, you probably already used an app to hail a ride or to pay for parking. But this is one of the first times that someone's really trying to bring it all together. The key is all the open data from the sensors and the resulting services are accessible through a single site. That's where SmartMay is ahead of the game.
So one single access point that can be used and personalized person by person. So in that case, I really believe that it will be part of our normal life and people will realize that they can really live better.
Project already has partners, including chip makers, developers, and the government. SmartMay is still in the prototype phase, but they've proven they can make it work.
We have now this kind of technology, we have now this level of knowledge in our university. And also because our national government has decided only now to put the money in this field.
The local government has committed about 13 million euros to tech projects like smart cities. Now they have to get ordinary people to buy into it.
So you have to convince them that this service can really improve their life, so they are in some sense forced or obliged to use these services as something normal.
One problem is that less than a fifth of residents are using their phones to access city services. This also seems like a massive privacy scandal just waiting to happen, though it's something the team says they're mindful of. But despite these hurdles, Messina and Catania are pulling ahead in the smart city race. Many bigger cities are taking a more conservative approach by focusing on individual projects instead of connecting an entire city. Chicago is digitally mapping its underground to prevent construction accidents, while Louisville is using sensors to listen for nearby alarms to respond to fires quickly. The fact is, it's challenging to make big changes in a big city.
You have to make some choices. You can't do it. Where is it that you have the maximum impact? How do you make, when you talk about it, relevant to people and not threatening, but welcoming? And that's what we're working on.
Still, it's odd that in Silicon Valley, the cities that house Facebook, Google, Apple, and Twitter become futuristic connected cities. Sure, there are driverless cars and you can use your phone to pay for parking meters, but there's no single way to access it all. Here's this place in the edge of Sicily on the verge of becoming one of the world's first truly smart cities. For one reason is the government, which is going to spend millions of euros in the local capital and make it happen. The other is that technology is better than it's ever been, but it's not a guaranteed success. If you don't use
Oh, we've got Antonio back.
Hi. Yes. Nice. I'm sorry. I was just talking, hey. But I realized only at the very end that I was completely disconnected.
Oh my God.
I'm sorry about that.
Hey, do not apologize. Do not apologize. We're happy to see you back, and we were kind of chatting and sharing the intro video from 2017. I hope folks now understand.
I don't know till when did you lose the I lost the connection. I don't know where I was at that point.
I know. I will tell you the slide before the chip. The last site was crowdfunding initiative University of Messina. Slide number 17 or something.
Okay, because I arrived at the end and I only then realized that that I was not online. I'm sorry about that.
It's all good. It's all good. It's human.
So,
to make-
I think that you were more or less here. I think. So
yes.
I apologize for this. I didn't realize.
We were worried that something terrible happening over there, that you lost phone lines and, like, you know, conspiracy theories.
No. there was nothing but just the connection that went down.
Next time I'm going to have your phone number, not just email. So you can start sharing the screen, present again and share whole screen.
Yes, okay, so I am starting again. Very sorry about that.
Hey, nothing to apologize, as long as you have time to finish.
So I think now I am sharing the screen, right?
Yes, that was the last slide we saw, and you were talking about crowdfunding.
Okay. So I was just saying that as a consequence of the introduction that was given so far, about 4 years ago, 5 years ago, we started a crowdfunding initiative at the University of Messina. So it's a crowdfunding project named hashtag SmartMe, where we try to involve the community in some ideas that were a project. It was quite unusual, because in Italy crowdfunding initiatives are not so popular, even less if you consider university that are launching a crowdfunding initiatives. But nevertheless, it was a success story, because we collected three times more than we were originally asking. But what is more important is that we start creating a community from the bottom. So we receive donation from citizens, students, researcher, small company, medium company, public office, administrative office. So it was extremely nice to see how this community was created. And we start working on this project. So it was, I think, an interesting idea that probably raised the interest from CBS, the video that you were looking at, from what I understood. Periodically just say, yes, so I understand that you are connected. Okay. So what we did, at the time we had a cooperation with Arduino. We started with low-cost hardware, Arduino-based hardware, and some evolution like TinkerShield and several kind of device sensors, low-cost sensors, to create objects like weather environmental monitoring station. And we created a first nucleus of this environment. Data were collected from many devices distributed around. Data were made publicly available. Part of them were stored to SICAN at the European level. So it was a nice experience. Also, the European Commission appreciated a lot of this project. These are just examples of very simple monitoring station, first release, and we were able to monitor around in the environment, collecting some data such as temperature, brightness, humidity, quality of the air, and more. Are you there? Yes.
Okay.
We involved some companies like this one that proposed a solution for smart parking with some devices that were put in the ground and were able to detect the presence or not of a car. But for example, another company proposed a different solution based on cameras that were monitoring the area and were able to analyze and understand if there was a free space or not. So also the involvement of companies, I think, is an interesting side effect that was generated by these crowd initiatives. This is the camera that now SmartMe.io provides. It's interesting because from the experience that was gained, this camera implements edge computing principle, because there is some simple hardware here that is able to collect the image, process locally, detect the objects we are interested in, and then transmit the numbers of these objects using LoRa protocol, so just few bytes. Of course, it preserves the privacy, because we don't recognize any face, anything. We all identify the objects. It's just an example. From this original idea, then we started another project that was financed by the Italian Ministry of Innovation, and the project is named TooSmart, and I think it's an interesting example of reusing of experience that was done in Messina, in our city, in other cities. The city where the city of Turin, Padua, Lecce, and Syracuse, that we trained, we explained how our environment was made, they installed, and we helped them to configure adequately. And now they are managing something like hundreds of environmental monitoring stations, several object detection cameras distributed in this city that share the same basic environment. And this is the TooSmart project. Now, we have been recently informed about a new project that is named SDLICE. It's an S3 project. It is now at the European level, and it intends to create a sort of federation of IoT infrastructure all over Europe. And we, with the CINI, are in charge of developing and deploying smart city services on this wide Europe wide infrastructure. So it's a project with a 15 years of time horizon, and it's equivalent in some sense to the GIAN projects, very interesting project, and we really hope that we will be able to transfer part of our research at the European level through this SDLICE framework. Another effect, you are connected, Res?
Yes.
So another collateral effects coming from this experience is the creation of a company. This is the smartme.io company. Originally, it's a startup, a spin-off from my university. Now is a company working on its legs alone. And we cooperate with this company that help us to bring into the market some of the products that we develop. Research products, research experience are transferred in commercial products. So, for example, SmartMe is managing the Arancino board, is managing the Stack for Things framework that I will mention immediately after. Arancino is an architecture, is here represented one of the possible Arancino boards. It's an hardware that is made of two separate parts. On one side, we have a microcontroller, like Arduino, to interact with the external world, the physical world. On the right, instead, we have a microprocessor. In this case, it's a Raspberry Pi compute module, but we can use also others. And all of them are in the same board, and there is a library that allows interaction between these two hemispheres. So on the same board, you have the possibility to interact with the sensors in the real world. These are click expansion slots. There are hundreds of different sensors available, and you can collect the data, and then you can process on board, okay, because it's a Linux machine, so you can implement edge computing. This is the basic components of environmental weather station, of LoRaWAN gateway, of smart camera, different products that are based on this technology. The other elements important when you deal with the smart city is, of course, the framework, the infrastructure, the software framework that you have to put in place. It is extremely important because we want to have a simple way to interact with the devices, with objects that are distributed around, geographically distributed. So we develop lots of effort in developing the Stack for Things framework. And the logic behind all of this is the following. Traditionally, you can have IoT device that generate data. These data are transferred into the cloud, and then they are maybe elaborated and offered to the final user through adequate service or app. This is the traditional way to organize everything. But of course, there are lots of many situations where it is not really convenient or feasible if you think to the latency that you have to experience to transfer the data into the cloud and then to bring back the results to the edge of your environment. Sometimes you have access through some API to some of the functionality offered by the device, but this is not so common. And also, usually we are talking about a proprietary solution. What we try to do is to bring the objects inside the cloud. Because in our mind, we say that if you have to set up an environment for a smart city, but also for a company, as a factory, you have lots of objects to consider. But you have also to consider computing, storage, and networking. These are the traditional elements to be considered in a cloud approach. But nowadays, you cannot imagine a cloud environment without IoT. Sensors and actuators. So we want to bring the edge device inside the cloud and to manage together with the traditional computing and storage resources to create the infrastructure. Once I create the infrastructure, then I can deploy my service, but I want to pick this virtual resource available around. So the idea is to integrate and extend the concept of the data center where you have computing, storage, networking. You can virtualize this resource and you can integrate with other virtual I/O resources that are physically installed somewhere else, like here in this figure, where I can create a network with this resource, then I integrate with some virtual computing elements, and maybe I can also include some other physical but remote device. So this is what we are trying to do, and this is the effort that has been developed in creating the Stafford Thing framework. I will tell you what the Stafford Thing is, but if you want just to focus your attention on the fact that at this point, practically everything can be managed at a software level. So we introduced the concept of software-defined city that tried to explain how through the proper use of software at a different level of my architecture, I can play, I can organize, I can manage this environment. So I have the lower level, the physical system, where there are the sensors, the actuators. Then they can be represented to this board, like the one I show you, that are able to receive and to actuate action. They are part of a network that is virtualized as well. And the full board are also virtualized inside the cloud. So at the cloud level, I have boards, computing, storage, networking, all these elements that are virtualized and can be integrated and combined to create my infrastructure. On top of this, I will deploy my service. And this is the concept of software-defined city that I would like to explain to you more. Different technologies are used there. This is just a list of some of them. But what is important is we are using open source approach, okay? So we made some experience with OpenStack. We believe OpenStack is an interesting and valid solution. It's an environment that is used not only in the research academy, but also in the industry for real project. It's maintained by a huge community with lots of developers. And it has all the mechanisms to virtualize and manage computing, networking, and storage resources. What we did is to start from OpenStack and extend with this new Stack for Things pillars that is in charge of the IoT. So all the sensors and actuators are managed through Stack for Things that is inside, fully integrated with the OpenStack. So computing, networking, storage, IoT are managed all together with an OpenStack approach. This is what we did. All the software is available open source on this repository that is inside the OpenStack project. There is a branch, so you can download if you want. Stack for Things is based on web socket, so we use HTTP. And specifically, we use the BAMP protocol, that is a WebSocket protocol that we found very interesting because it allows to connect a board, a device distributed everywhere in the internet with the cloud, and using Stack for Things and the components, that is the Stack for Things Iotronic running on the cloud and Lightning Rod on the board itself, I create communication channel so that the board is visible through the cloud. The board is announced when I switch on. It interacts with Iotronic, Stack for Things Iotronic, through a reverse tunneling mechanism. Then the cloud see the board as a server. So the board exposes services to the rest of the world. Okay, each board is potentially a server that provides some service. And as we are using HTTP, we can go to NAT and firewall without problem. Because we thought a lot about this, and we cannot imagine to create a smart city complex as you want, imagine that you can interact, you can enter the local area networks of the provider of these sensors. No way of doing that. But using this approach, we can pass through traditional potential problems such as firewall and NAT without any difficulties. So this is the way in which the system is structured. We have a component of the board. Another one is an extra service of OpenStack, the Stack for Things Iotronic. There are several communication channels that ensure the communication between the cloud and the boards and vice versa. This is the general architecture where the things are put in this queue, then one by one are extracted, then I use the BAMP agents to interact with the board, different channel, data channel, configuration channel, communication channel, so we can ensure this communication without problem between the boards and the cloud. And on the boards, we have the Lightning Rod components that is able to interact with the different service that the board is exposing. So the board is like a server. You can contact automatically, and then you have access to the specific service. It could be to SSH, HTTP, and then you have the sensor connected there that provides the data that they are collecting. This means that we can talk about sensing and actuation as a service because at this point we have several contributors with their own sensor networks. I can integrate all of them. I can pick some of the resources that they expose. I can combine in my infrastructure, maybe together with other resources available in the cloud. And then on top of this infrastructure, I deploy my service and any users can connect and access. To manage all of this, we have to deal with access rights, of course, different people, different role, and also we have to ensure the immutability of the data that are generated by the board itself. So this is why we have recently extended the Stack for Things, also integrating with the blockchain technology. And this is used on one side to ensure access and access rights, and on the other side to record the information, the data that are collected, and to have a distributed ledger that is immutable. Okay. Stack for Things provide service forwarding, as I tried to explain to you. So on the cloud, I contact this server on the cloud, then redirects the request, changing ports on equivalent on the boards that allow access to the real local service. This is the way in which it works. Stack for Things also provide plugin that can be configured in terms of JSON objects, and they specialize the behavior of the boards. So you can update, you can modify if the case. Through interaction with the Neutron service provided by OpenStack, we are able to implement virtual networks, including also our boards. So at the physical layer, you have the different devices connected here. Then we can abstract and create a local network that put together some of the boards and some of the service, computing and storage. This is an abstraction process extremely important that allow to create different slices on your physical network, different infrastructure depending on the service that you have to deploy. This is the way in which this networking is managed on the cloud side and also on the board side, okay? Practically, this means, for example, like in use case one, that inside the same domain, I can have a different board logically connected in the blue network and others in the red network. But I can also have a different domain connected to the internet, and I can pick up and mix boards in network one with boards in network two and logically group in one new slice of my system. And here you have the blue one, different networks. Or as in use case three, where I mix edge components, edge device with traditional computing and storage resources, virtual machine on the cloud. Or as in the fourth use case, where I also include UMTS, so connectivity to smartphone. This is important because I really believe that 5G will have an extremely important role in smart city, and not only, also in private company. So I imagine private 5G installed to give support to production site in the future, where, for example, you have a manned vehicle that have to move to bring object from one point to another, and you can use 5G to control and send commands to this device with extremely high precision. So at the same time, you have edge computing and 5G mixed together. Well, our system is able and ready to be used also in such kind of scenario. A further extension of Stack for Things is the function as a service that we are using, in the sense that at this point, as we have so many flexibility in creating our infrastructure, we can use device, boards, also to host simple, small, little function that provides some computational effect. We call this function as a service. Understanding the OpenStack service, Chilling and Zoom, we are able to provide this sort of environment where a complex problem is divided in a simple function. This function through Chilling are distributed in our infrastructure inside the different IoT devices or in general computing resources, and then they can be orchestrated using Node-RED, is a graphical programming language, so I can describe very easily how the different functions are called and they interact each other. So the framework is already implemented, is available, and it's an interesting extension that allow to implement edge computing for computing in our future cities. This brings to the Web of Things concept, because at this point, objects are fully integrated, easily reachable, connected in our environment. So this is why we call about Web of things. And to further exploit this concept, we implemented using NGX reverse proxy, a mechanism that allowed to have a physical resource like a board somewhere on the internet, and to make it immediately reachable through DNS to potential user. So this is the address that I want to announce, vot.raspuniv.feluca.eu. So the public domain is feluca.eu, and this can be solved using DNS, public DNS. At that point, it will point to a OpenStack service implemented inside the Stack for Things, where it will add and resolve the second part, just pointing, as shown here, to this NGX proxy, where the Rasp Univ IoT is sold, redirecting the request to the physical board, and then changing again the ports to the specific service that I'm looking at. Last, in this case, the temperature service. In this way, the objects are easily reachable without anything to be done. And here I have a simple demo. I don't know if I am able to show you. Are you still connected, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yep, we're all here.
So let me see if, I don't know why. Okay, maybe now. Let me see. Okay, yes, this is a simple service that we have developed for you. And as you can see, there is a camera looking at this breadboard where there are two LED. And of course, there is an Arancino board here. Using simple HTTP command, I can interact with these objects, for example, switching on the red light or switching on the green one, and off. So only HTTP command, there is no configuration, absolutely nothing to be done, and I am interacting with these remote objects, okay? It is not on my desk, I am in Syracuse, and this thing is Messina, about, yes, about 200 kilometers for where I am, okay? Just a very simple example that I hope show the complexity of what is behind, but at the same time also the simplicity with this software and this framework that I show you. Okay,
Prof, I just want to mention that even the board, it doesn't have a public IP address. It's behind a NAT, and we don't have any VPN. You can even access. I just shared with you the link from US, from Canada. You can reach it. You can reach the board and interact with it.
Yes.
It doesn't.
Yes.
It doesn't have a public IP address.
Yes, you can just have this is the address. So you can copy and you can try even now and do exactly the same. So you are not configuring anything and you can test immediately this feature. This brings an open to the concept of Web of Things, because really objects can be group, although they are physically spread in the internet, and they can contact and use accessing the service that they provide through the web. So Web of Things concept that brings to this figure where the different solution available then can be made somehow uniform to the concept of Web of Things on top of it. Okay. Before completing, I wanted just to show you the portal that has been developed for the management of this fleet of devices. You can define your projects, maybe the smart lighting, the smart parking, environmental monitoring station. You can group the different devices, and you have the full control of all of them. You can access to what they generate the data, and you have also information regarding the behavior of the object itself. So these things, I try to give you another short video that is the following, just to show how this system is organized and how relatively simple is to control and create your infrastructure. So here we are entering the system. As you see, there are different projects that can be defined. Here we created some for you, like the street lighting or the smart ME project itself on the environmental station, like here. We are entering, and you have a list of the different devices that are available there. Here we have one station that is located in the offices of SmartMe, the blue point there. And you have all the information regarding the device itself, as it is shown here. So you have, just delay because it was done real time, so now it will access the device that will answer. It will show where it is, all the information there, and you can see that the IoTronic service is running. You see that Arancino architecture is there with all the piece of software, and you have access to the data. It's a simple monitoring station for temperature, humidity. You can play with this graph that can be managed. You can enlarge, you can do many things about that. And what is also interesting is that you have also access to specific information that are related to the device itself. So not only the data as it is here shown that it collects, but data on the behavior of the device. So it means the CPU usage, the temperature, the amount of memory, the networking activity that the device is doing. And it is extremely important when you are to play with a fleet of these devices, and you have to control and manage all of them in the proper way. Okay. So I think the video, okay, yes, it's over. And, okay, go back. Okay, then I think I have completed. And here you have some literature, if you want to go more in details. There are also even more papers that you can we can suggest to you. And many thanks for your attention. I apologize for the problem related with the connectivity. And I hope you like. And of course, I am here available for questions and answer to your observation. Many thanks again to you all.
Thank you so much, Antonio. Thank you for your visit. So if I can start with the question, like I like the end details of the networking and open source tech. Is there a getting started guide? How would somebody take that and play with it? Or we need a separate meetup for that? Like Zakaria, new to the project, how did you start? Like, is there a place you go to, GitHub clone, and then have your own?
I can tell you what we did, for example. Okay, this year in the Cini consortium, we organize a challenge that there is a global problem that an industrial board of Cini has identified, that is the Green Deal problem in general, and specifically the smart mobility, okay? So this is the general topic that have been assigned to students of several universities distributed all over Italy. So in the last 6 months, different group of students have been involved in thinking and proposing some solution related with smart mobility. In Messina, there are four groups, and one of them is interested in smart parking, so they develop a solution. Another one on smart monitoring. Another one analyzed several set of data of the New York area regarding the call for taxi, and they were able to understand on Monday at this time where the more requests were generated and more. So they are students, and they started learning what is OpenStack. They started learning what is Stack for Things. So there are some documents they were able to follow, and all the documents, and they installed their setup, their framework. And then we gave them some weather station or LoRa gateway devices that they were able to configure and install. So really, I don't think there is special requirements or deep knowledge on these things, mm-hmm. because students, smart students, but always students, mm-hmm. they were able to prepare, and they really did a very good job. So I was very happy about the way in which they contribute, the interest that they show. And now they are participating into this competition, so I don't know what is going to happen. In September, we will know where they will be ranked. So again, complexity, I think, is relatively simple, and the same we experience with the city, the municipality of Turin, Padova, and Syracuse, where people of the administration, so probably engineer, I don't know, they were trained and they were able to set up and start the system. So I think it can be done. We didn't experience special problems.
So if there is interest, you'll find some links. Zakari, you want to say something?
Sure. Yeah, I want just to point out that everything we are doing is open source. So you can find the projects on the OpenStack official repo. I will share with you the links right now. Mm-hmm. So you can just download the project, do some configuration, which is very easy for someone who is working with OpenStack. So you just
networking and infrastructure. But when we invited people from the cities, they're not into cables. They're more like abstract. How I can help you? So you were, when we had one-on-one chat, you were telling us about some use cases, volcanic landsliding. Maybe you can touch up on that.
Sorry, Daniel. I lost Daniel. I don't know if. Sorry, Daniel, but for about 10 seconds, we could not hear you.
Sorry. So in the meetup invite that we shared on social media, we mentioned some of the projects, because people from the cities, those that are going to start communities, they don't know technology and networking. It's us to help them. But how to motivate them? For instance, like, can you share some more light about pothole detection? How did you implement that one? For instance,
yes,
or landslide, or the land. Like, we can go one by one.
Yes. I show you some of the services, like the parking and the smart lighting, but there are also more. For example, you mentioned this pothole detection. Pothole detection is a service that requires as device the mobile phone of the user. So there is a simple app that the user can install on his mobile phone. And this app is able to detect a sudden variation of acceleration along the zeta axis. So while you are traveling, if you enter a pothole, probably you have a movement like this and a signal is sent. If there are lots of signal of this kind in the same limited geographical area around the pothole, then we assume it's a pothole. And it's a sort of crowd sourcing approach, very simple to implement. And we tested several times with lots of students, that and in about 3 days of activity, we were able to map more or less 80% of the pothole in the central part of Messina, because the students were doing their life, they were going up and down, and they generated all this data, and then we elaborated. So this is a way to involve people. Another thing that we develop is a sort of a complementary coin that was developed, Unime coin. It's a sort of social experiment where the citizen buy this virtual coin, and in doing that, if the change is one-to-one, they receive double, because the university was providing the complementary, no, the double. So at the end of the year, in the bank, there was a bunch of money. And at that point, what is the idea is that we use this money for social purposes. So the citizens vote, and they say the real money that are there can be used to buy books, to support this activity and so on. And this project was awarded by the G7 Transport Committee 2 years ago in Sardinia. What I think important is that citizens are to be part of the game. And of course, this is not a technological problem. We, as a researcher, can do something, but you need lots of cooperation from the administration to publicize, to create the condition that people can really use the system. And people use the system if they are some return, if they gain, maybe in simplicity, in reducing the time to find a parking place, in saving money. I don't know, there are many possibilities. But the role of the municipality is crucial at that point. And at the same time, also, as I mentioned, you need this private public partnership to ensure sustainability in time. So a private company that can help in maintaining the system, of course it will have its gain from the service. And the final point is, let's avoid to have one app per service, because people, they have already too many apps on their mobile phone. So the app should be one, very simple, where all the basic services can be immediately accessed. And this is another thing that I think is important if you want to start a new process.
That is awesome. So I pasted in the chat some of the projects we spoke about before. So in the video, you did cover environmental monitoring. Yes. In the video that I shared with the audience while you were gone, smart partings are implementing as a device under the car. Yet in the presentation, you talk about the cameras. Which one is it? Are you
both,
using
both? Both. I see. We are using both of them because the camera is simpler, maybe faster to install, but there are some situation where the camera could not be adequate. If the parking, for example, is covered by a roof, or if there is trees, then you have to use both technology. Mm-hmm. And for the final user, it doesn't make any difference because the app is always the same and you know where there is free space or not. But the data are generated sometime by the camera, sometime by the sensors on the ground that have other kind of difficulties, because the sensor on the ground, you need to put the cable, to bring the electricity. So they are more complex, but in some case you cannot use only cameras.
So the question now, if my city decides to use one of your projects, so we know how to start SmartME, to start the dashboards, to connect the devices, stack, but are these sub-projects, like these dishes that you're cooking, can I download the smart parking app? Can I download pothole detection app? Can I download the like garbage bins? That's something I didn't even see until we were waiting for you.
Yes, for example, the environmental station, low-cost environmental station, they are a commercial product that can be bought and they can be easily installed. And at the moment, we already installed more than hundreds of these devices in the different cities I was mentioning, and they are all collecting data. So it's an object that you buy. The smart camera, the same. It's an object, can be bought and installed. Recently, three of these cameras were acquired by the city of Wolfsburg in Germany, the city of Volkswagen, and they installed in some area to monitor crowd and the number of citizens in some square, in some street of the city. So they installed and they are using it together with the Stack 14 framework. So
but that's hardware. How about software? Is it part of the basic installation or it's somebody else gives me?
Yes. There is the hardware and the software. Consider, for example, that in these weeks, in the city of Milan, we are cooperating with a company that is named Meridionale Impianti, and they are using our framework to organize a complete area of the city of Milan that is named Lorenteggio. It's a very wide area where we are installing smart lighting, environmental monitoring station, noise detector, cameras, parking, smart parking device, and so on more, because this area will be a real example of a smart city with lots of different process there. So they are putting all the cables, physically all the cables, but the software part is based totally on Stack for Things, that in the specific case has been also integrated with Elastic. It's a commercial product that the municipality of Milan is already using. So they wanted to integrate both of them. At the beginning, they didn't understand why to use Stack for Things. Now they fully got the point, because it simplifies the interaction with all the devices that are distributed around. So they really appreciate a lot, and we have integrated both environment, so Stack for Things for dealing with all these sub-projects and the tens and tens, hundreds of devices distributed around, Elastic to collect this data and then to search for this data. So it's a very nice integration, very powerful. Cool. I think that everything will be ready probably immediately after the summer. We are already 70% of the implementation already done. So there is the software. Sorry, Daniel.
No, sorry. I was sorry. I thought you finished. I apologize.
No. Yes, I done. This project will be operative by the end of this year. Now they are really physically installing everything, about 200 lamps in the streets. So there are some physical infrastructure that they are creating.
This is, I'm so happy at the set at the same time. I'm so happy for you, for Italy, that things are moving forward. And I'm afraid for North America, it's going to be like fireworks, bright ideas, and then darkness again. It's going to be another 5 years before anybody acts on anything. So how can we make this meetup more useful for the world after us? Maybe you mentioned the importance of communities. Like, we are too small. Piggyback, can we point people to join your communities? Because links point to the products, but we need a leader, somebody to say, okay, let's now build a pothole app, let's now build a lamp. For, like, do you have those communities that we can join worldwide?
Yes, this is possible, but of course, to start, you need someone that takes the initiatives. Usually the city apply to some public fund, they have some money, and they decided to start with one project. Sometimes it's difficult to afford all the different projects at the same time. But what I think is important is that you have to create an environment that is general enough to host the smart lighting, the smart parking, the garbage collection, and so on. You don't need to install a new, completely different environment every service you want. Mm-hmm. So I believe the Stack for Things offer these characteristics. And it has been proved exactly in this example I was mentioning in Milan. The different services, like the bins for the garbage, the lighting, they are produced by different providers, different companies. We don't know them. Of course, now we got in touch with them because we receive some specification of their camera, their product, but we immediately integrated. Okay. And this is the power of this approach. The framework is the same, but it is managing and controlling at least 10 or 12 different kind of services. Like, for example, also the bang, because in Europe now, if you have some detectors, if there is an explosion from a gun or something like that, you have to identify. Just to tell you, so this project in Lorenteggio really is an extremely powerful example, because we have lots of different objects to be interconnected, and all of them produced by different companies that don't know each other. And the framework is absolutely the same. So for the manager, it's important. He has not to learn a new way to control and interact with the device. It's the same. It's managed by the API provided by Stanford Things. That's it. And you can add new components and enlarge your system in time without having to start from scratch every time. So this is important, I think.
So you mentioned you have competition in September with students. So is there a social network, media channel, Slack channel, some place where hobbyists can tag along and listen for inspiration to you? Because I'm afraid you're going to go and this is going to be like, again, nothing in North America. How can we help North America? What should we do?
Well, some years ago, we were asked from the the consul, the Italian consul in Boston, to set up something to communicate and inform the Boston area of results about Arduino. At that time, we set up a box where there was a simple Arduino board with some sensors and a book with 15 examples. And the console helped us to create a class of students collected in the area. I don't know in which way. They had no technical expertise. They were completely mixed. And we provide this starter kit to them. We deliver five lectures, meetings in the afternoon, and they were able at the end to create those examples. It was a very nice experience, and we replicated this in Italy with a starter kit that is made of an environmental weather station that is completely in the different small components, you know? So we explain something about the technology to these students, high school students. They keep on putting together, they mount, they create their objects, they configure, and they install in their school. So some of the weather station in Turin and Padua has been mounted by students, and now they are in charge of ensuring the proper functioning of this device. If there are serious problems, of course, the company then will substitute or modify, but they learn playing. And we also made some experiments, other class where we pass the same information in a traditional way, like a lecture where I talk and they listen. The results were completely different. When they do things, they mount and they have something that switch on with lights and they receive data, they get enthusiastic. And so the final results is completely different.
So that is the answer. This is a little practical. Go ahead, guys. I hijacked Antonio.
Totally makes sense that people hands-on are going to, you know, adopt it a lot more. Do you think that as time goes on and more, you know, teenagers and younger people have grown up with smart houses now? You know, you can ask Alexa to turn on your sprinkler. You can, you know, integrate your TV with your watch and all this kind of thing. Do you think that as the younger crowd is growing up with that, that they're going to be more champions for the smarter, broader area like a city going forward?
Yes, I think that this generation is in the best condition to benefit from these things because they are not scared. They already are used in clicking here and there, and they have a positive approach toward technology. So I don't think the problem is the new generation, but they have to be educated to understand how the technology can be used and also what are the drawbacks in terms of privacy and security. Of course, we have to always remember these things. But they learn very quickly. A little bit more difficult is to involve all generation because they use the mobile phone, but they are a little bit scared. So they have to be convinced that they gain something in using this technology. And this is why it's important a training action that you have to bring in the city. For example, if you have a new projects and you want to start a new service, you have to inform people, you have to create a way to let them test and assess. And of course, the system has to be done simple, intuitive. And if people get aware and they really understand that they simplify their life, then they will use. So it's difficult, it's a long process, and this is why I said it's an action that you have to carry on involving the research institution, so maybe the university, research center in the area. You have to involve consumer association, you have to involve the municipality. It's a concerted action because each of these category can help and find a way to communicate the novelty. Otherwise people are reluctant. They already have so many apps, so many services. It's difficult. This is a very complex process, I think. Maybe more complex than the technological one.
Absolutely, yeah. Do we have any other questions from the broader group here?
Anything we forgot to ask him? Zakari, I was asking you for the GitHub repo for the pothole app because it's crazy how bad the roads are. And the same way we carry COVID apps for notification, we can install one of your apps, and that would be low-hanging fruit how to penetrate with your product this market without any hardware.
Yeah, I'm checking, Daniel, but I'm not sure if it is available on GitHub. I don't know. Professor, it is available there, the pothole app?
The pothole application?
Yeah.
I have not on, I don't know. I can see, but I'm not sure that I can. How can I show now?
That's okay.
But you can it can be activated easily. This of the pothole was a sort of really experiment. It has been tested, I think, a lot. It is not used in the other cities, at least at the moment, because they decided all together to start from the environmental monitoring station for the effect that this can have on the population. Mm-hmm. So a direct impact. And for example, the city of Wolfsburg asked us to develop a lamp. It's a simple lamp with the colors, but this lamp is able to detect and analyze the quality of the air where it is installed. And then through LoRa, transfer the data that it collects to the cloud. So they're using this lamp in the schools to understand when it is more convenient to open the window, for example, during the winter, to change the air. So it's something that came from their side. And then using the Arancino board and some 3D printers, we created the project. And they installed 30 or 35 of these lamp in some school. So different area, different requirements. So
pothole landslides. Landslides, you mentioned, we were talking one-on-one about landslides, and now with Japan, yeah. Like there is lots of areas in the world with climate change that would benefit from that. Can you share some?
Yeah, yes. This landslides was developed with a company, I already mentioned Meridionale Impianti, and it is done in this way. You drill in the ground and you install a long pipe between 20 and 30 meters length. They are put into the ground. Inside this pipe, there is a chain of inclinometers on three axes connected with a wire. And then there is another one, and you put these things inside the pipe. Okay, everything is with battery and solar panel to charge the battery. When there is a landslide and the ground move, this pipe is a little bit compressed. So this little change are detected by the inclinometer inside the pipe that immediately send this change. And it has been tested, experienced, and it's very precise and relatively low cost. So more expensive is to drill and everything. But this is the solution that was adopted.
Very cool. And who is using that? Is it Italy or?
I think that the company is has already installed this inclinometer in some area in Italy. I don't know exactly where, but I can tell you that the system that I try to explain, to describe, is now being used by a group of important companies in Italy to monitor some parts of the highways where there are bridges and tunnels. We, SmartMe, is monitoring something like 15,000 sensors in real time every day that are inclinometer and accelerometer that has been installed in several bridges, so or tunnel. So if the bridge is moving or is undergoing some degradation of whatever it is, the data are immediately collected, transferred, and then there are some civil engineers that are able to understand if the system is still in a secure area or if it is potentially going to fall down. So these things is managed through Stack4Things. The sensors are developed by ST Microelectronics. Everything is put in place by Sacertis, is this company. And then there is Autostrade per l'Italia, is the owner of the highway. So there are hundreds and hundreds of kilometers that we are managing in this way. So it's a different application, but the underlying software and concept is the same. Mm-hmm. Different kind of sensors, of course, with the lots of problem, reliability, and so on, but the framework is the same.
Mm-hmm. And what I like, you were talking about device management and shadow devices. When we spoke, you mentioned that how some cloud vendors copied that concept from your research. So it's not Mickey Mouse, it's a real solution that you can use.
Yes, these are a solution. Yeah. If people, it's open source, so they can download, they can use, or they can ask for support. Mm-hmm. It's something a little bit also complex, of course. So, and then what we realize is that you have always to personalize this solution to the specific problem. So, of course, we are faster in personalizing because we know the detail. Another application that it's extremely nice, I think we have an agreement with trailer manufacturer in Italy that is named Technocar. They produce a big truck, the very big one. They're leader in Italy and in Europe of this. And we develop for them a solution that is based on Stack4Things and several kind of sensors that are installed on this truck. And they collect information about the weight, the acceleration, the speed, if it is overloaded or not, if they get a pothole in a wrong way. The driver can control this big truck from a mobile phone. They can open, close, turn. We collect all the data in real time, are transferred to the central cloud, and the company make also preventive maintenance from this data. So they analyze and they try to predict if there is some potential situation, critical situation, and maybe they will ask for the truck to be fixed in some place. Mm. So it's another application, and we are producing about 1,000 of this truck per year. All the new trucks of this company are provided with our Arancino-based hardware, of course, tailored to their requirements, and the Stack4Things software to control this fleet of real truck going around Europe.
That's nice. Thank you so much for sharing. So we are half an hour over our lunch, and it's quite long Friday lunch. So I don't know if people can go or have to go or can stay. But as for me, I have. Thank you so much for this. Any other questions for Antonio? If you have to go, it's everybody's so quiet. You can unmute yourself. This is Q&A. I just had a bunch of questions.
On the finance, you talked about financial sustainability a little bit, and I remember you saying something that when some people were contributing, there was a university matching program and dollar for dollar or something like that. But how do you address the ongoing financial sustainability? Like, for example, you said there's a unified app. There's one app that the general public uses. Does that app have ads as a source of income or no?
Okay. This is the model that you can imagine. Of course, if there are ads, then this is why I was thinking to I suggest a public-private approach, because usually what I experience is that at least in Italy, in Europe, you have some source of fund. You apply to a project, you receive the money, you are very excited, you start, you set up everything. After 2 years, you prove that the things is done, is working, and the project is over. So you have no more money. And after some time, you have to switch off everything because nobody is paying for the system. So sustainability is one extremely important element to be considered, because if we do project, the project usually finish with the project itself. But if you have a company, so there is a commercial interest there, you can find the condition and the solution so that the system can be maintained even after the project is over. And this is extremely important, and you have to think early to this possibility. When the project is finished, it's too late.
But what's the revenue source? Like, you got to think about it and plan it. So what's the answer? What's the revenue stream that the company pulls from in order to pour money into the project after the finish line is passed?
But this, I think, can be done with some concertation action at the beginning. When you try to start a new project, you can open a concertation action where you ask the company in the area or in general, this is my idea. I would like to have this service with the general characteristics. Help me. I listen. I try to collect idea from one side to another, from another. Then sometime you can also have a first phase where you select some of this proposal. You put some money and you ask them to have a sort of little project where they try to prove the general ideas. Then you can select three of them, the most promising, and you go more in detail, you put a little bit more money, and you try to expand and make it even better. Then, practically, you have already tested several technologies and solutions, and you can have an open call where you know exactly what to ask for. And you can also ask for the involvement of private actors that collaborate with you. And of course, it will gain. It will gain from the ads. It will gain from some percentage on each time the system use and so on. And at the end, you can pass. You can transfer part of the responsibility to these private elements. Because otherwise, I don't know. I don't think that the municipality on its own is able to maintain, because they have already so many problems in their mind. So new things, they are not able, and they are not fast in reacting.
Mm-hmm. So it has to be collaborative, private, public. That's what we learned.
Yeah, I think it's one interesting solution to be investigated in this kind of project regarding Marcy.
For people who have to go, it's already after 2 p.m. About normally at the end of the meetups, we do mining raffle, but we spend so much time. I have a suggestion if the group doesn't mind. Zakari was very helpful of tracing you down and sending the links here. There is so much unanswered questions after the meetup. I would like discussion to continue. Since there is no public format, I would like to ask Zakari to be a bridge to your team. And in order to bribe him, let's give him the mining product of his choice. Would that be okay, John? You're smiling like it's...
Oh, it's certainly fine with
5 minutes.
Yeah.
Hmm? Anybody else?
I think it's a good idea. Yeah. If Zakari is up for being a hub of information or...
Until we build a social club.
Sure.
So Zakari, so you will go to mining.com website, choose any product you like, put your email address here for others to see and for me to tell mining to give you whatever you want from their products. That's kind okay. of just... paying it forwards because you're helping us.
Okay, thank you. Okay.
Okay. So if everybody else is okay. So let's continue with questions. Like I can still stay. I checked, there is no more meetings for me here. So I can hang with Antonio. And anybody else, any questions? this is too important to just stop here. Like, it's going to be dark again. Look at that video from 2017. We had made no progress in this continent. How do we help Toronto, Canada, United States?
But also another thing that I would like to add is that from some analysis, the big city with more than 1 million of inhabitants probably are around 80, 100 all over the world. So when you think to smart city, immediately your mind goes to this megalopoly and this big city. But most of the population lives in cities that are about 100,000 to 200,000 inhabitants. So completely different dimension. And I think that it is also worth focusing on this kind of reality. So probably it's relatively easier to interact with the public administration there, with the management of the city, because of smaller cities, smaller problems, and you can start from there. So this is another aspect that I think should be considered. Don't go with the big city because the problems are big, but with the reality where most of the people live. In the sides of 100,000 to 100,000 citizens.
That's a good one. Any other tips? Like, have you seen any other country adopting what you do? So Italy, it's the same law system. It's even Europe. Have you seen other parts of the world successfully copying some of your projects?
We have this interaction with Wolfsburg in Germany. They already installed Stack for Things and the lamp, as I mentioned, and the smart camera. We have an agreement with the city of Tangeri in Morocco, and I hope that in the future we will be able to concretize something. So we are participating with a sort of it's a company located in the UK, and they will act as a sort of proxy, and we ask for Germany to have contacts in Germany. So I hope that in the next 6 months we will have some more interaction with some German city.
Well, and you mentioned starter kit in Boston. Like, can one order buy those starter kits? Is there a kind of onboarding to
help? Yes, the starter kits, the environmental station, or the starter kit of the environmental station, yes, it's available, can be ordered and used.
Cool. Yeah, I had a problem with shipping from Italy. Do we have distributors in North America for the hardware?
No, not yet.
But okay, this is opportunity.
We can manage. I think we will find a solution for this.
Anything else we forgot to ask you, Antonio? You're in this space so long. We don't know what we don't know. So anything else you wish we asked you?
No, I don't know exactly. I think we touch both to the technological part, the organization management. So I think that more or less we touch the different angles that we have to consider when we want to deal with such complex projects, because smart city is a complex project. It's very complex because there are many technological issues and a huge number of users. So it's a extremely difficult, much more than a company, because the user in a company has in the number of thousands, okay, and there is definitely someone that can say, this is the solution, this is what we have to do. But in the city, this is not. So probably, I think this is why it's also complex, and it takes more time, because you have to really convince people to use it. You have no other way to force them.
And you mentioned you had a problem approaching cities if it was not open source solution, that it was hard to sell different clouds to city authorities.
What we realize is that many city manager, they are a little bit scared when big companies they go there and offer solution, because usually they have to pay for license, and they are scared because again, they know that they have the money probably now. There is a project that has been financed. And then what is going to happen? So if you talk about open source solution that is available, supported by many developers here and there, they are definitely more relaxed. They are relaxed because they don't see any immediate problem there. We are talking about public institution in any case. Mm-hmm. So open source is well considered from them.
So now it's open source, they chose it. Do they like to, based on the cities that adopted your projects, do they like to host it themselves in their data centers, or they install it in Amazon, Azure, or Google? What do you see? What is the distribution of installation?
It depends. Some cities install directly on their infrastructure because they had already an infrastructure and also the people able to manage. That is not simple. Some others on Amazon, Google, and so on. But now in Italy, I know Europe, there is a new law that says that public data should be kept under control. Maybe Italian data should be kept in Italy and France in France, avoid to big all the data to operators that belongs to other countries. So of course it depends on the kind of data, but the idea is to have some national cloud data center that has been certified. So also the public administration will have the opportunity to access this governmental data center. So I think at that point that probably most of the city will adopt the solution, because for them it's not always so easy to manage a data center, a cloud or something like that, because they need lots of developers, programmers, and usually they are not organized to deal with these things.
And the last question for me, I'll let others ask after, if you can stay. So you, I know you started your research before cloud vendors were IoT ready, fleet management, shadow devices. So you have a bunch of good projects. Have you noticed that some of the cloud vendors took some of your projects and changed the infrastructure, not to run it a smart stack, but in their cloud? Which, like, I remember I saw pothole detection, a garbage bin detection, Amazon in Brazil. They had the project, but I had no clue. Is it related to your work?
No. Let's say that I am not aware.
Okay.
I saw something and some similarities in some other projects, but I cannot say that they took.
It's not finger pointing. It just that means there is an overlap. There is overlap between, because there are people who say, I don't want to manage my software. I'd rather commit to the vendor. So truth is in between. It's 50 shades of gray. So what are the most popular projects here? Maybe let's revise the question. In these 9 projects you listed that you've seen adopted outside of your software stack in some clouds?
Well, the environmental station is the service that it seems that people like more, and also the smart cameras. Mm-hmm. Probably smart camera also due to the COVID, so to avoid lots of people in the same area, they want to send alarms, I don't know. But this one are at the moment the services that are more requested.
Cool.
Now we will ask another sort of service, but you see, when you talk with the people, then a new idea comes. They are interested in the intensity of the wind. They don't need the direction, only intensity, because there is some rules that if you have to do some activity, you have to work outside, if the wind is over a given value, you cannot work. So this is a company that manages the repeater of UMTS, the connectivity for mobile phone. And if there is a problem, they send the group of workers somewhere. They arrive, the wind is too much, and they go back. So they ask us a simple and economic device that they can install on this pole or whatever they are, and they send information about the wind. So we adapt our Arancino, the small one, and without battery, solar panel, and everything, just by the wind itself, it receives the right amount of energy, and they transfer to LoRa few bytes that say this is the intensity. So before going there, they already know what is the situation. So very economic and simple device.
That is awesome. Go ahead.
Yeah. Controlled by the environment that you are seeing.
And I give Zachary homework because you're the teacher, you know everything. We cannot use more of your time. It would be cool if Zachary can document list of the whole projects and the links where people can learn more. That can be a lead magnet for other cities, other companies to approach you and start using your software. Because we didn't know. We don't know what we don't know. You just taught us about wind. It's a perfect use case. And it's one.
Yes, yes. We are trying to collect this information. So on the website of SmartMe, there is an area where there are documents and reports. So, but of course, we can do better and more. Yes, I agree.
So we'll help, like whatever we can. This is non-profit. We do it like for the lunch breaks and in the evenings. You to help the world be better. So, thank you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
Anything else? Any last thoughts before? Like, I can still stay. Like, I don't want to let you go. This is so cool, unique opportunity. Anybody else wants to? We lost 2,000.
We can also interact whenever you want. Also, now there are these instruments, so anytime we can set up a room, or we can have a chat. So you can contact directly through email, as you prefer, WhatsApp. So we are available and to discuss with people.
It should be scalable. You're a single person. It should be scalable. Like even like you know, Jesus, he had disciples. You need people to spread what you know. We shouldn't be going to you all the time. So we need
to but there are also of course, but there are other people then that can support and help depending on the specific service and application. We have people that are qualified for doing that. So not only me, there are also other people that.
It's okay if you share your email in the forum for people.
Sure, definitely.
But if you, whatever you learn, please know to whoever reads this email, whatever you learn, share it with the rest of us. It shouldn't be one-on-one. It should be collective brain. So thank you.
Thank you very, very much. I enjoyed a lot and I found very stimulating, very interesting. And of course, we are all available to
thank you
more in details with you if you have ideas and we can try to support in any as much as we can. Of course, we are very much interested in making new experience, so please contact us through Daniel anytime and we will try to help.
But I'm just a seed planter and the matchmaker and connector with the ideas. So I'd be happy if this takes life of its own. So we did our work. We introduced the world to your teachings.
Thank you.
Hopefully there's social media somewhere. So thanks again.
Thank you. Thank you again and be in touch. Definitely.
Definitely. Zachary, you as well. So we'll be working.
Okay, Daniel. Yeah.
Stay safe, everyone. Have a wonderful weekend.
Have a great day. You too.
Thank you. Yeah. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Daniel. Bye-bye. Bye.
Thank you, Daniel. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Daniel. Thanks a lot.